Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our July board meeting, and welcome to, I'm gonna take the microphone for some personal announcement. And my announcement is that this morning at 6:30 p.m., my great-granddaughter was born. Her name is Georgia Lee. Now, some serious matter, will have vocation from Sandy Woolsey. Just get close.
Okay.
Or hold it up.
My paper or this?
No, the microphone.
Okay. Dear Heavenly Father, with so much turmoil in the world around us, we are thankful for the peace that we find in you. Give us wisdom as individuals in our daily lives and nationally among our leaderships. Give wisdom as we provide aid to war-torn countries. I pray for the families who have lost loved ones and are struggling with basic needs. As we grow nearer to our national elections, give us wisdom as we select new leaders. We pray for Plymouth Place families. Some families have lost loved ones and others are dealing with health issues. Meet their needs. Give strength and wisdom to their caregivers. Remind us individually and as a nation, of the love and blessings you bestow. Thank you. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you, Sandra. I'll ask you all to rise at this time, if you're able, and join the singing sages in the singing of God Bless America. Before they start, I want you to notice the numbers of the singing sages. They have grown tremendously since we started doing this. So feel free to join them. They're just going to do it once. Please join them. Thank you, Susan, for accompanying us. Next agenda item is the approval of the minutes of the meeting from April 30th. Do I hear anyone offering any suggestions, questions, or additions to the minutes as they were distributed? Hearing none, can we have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second? Thank you. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. Thank you. We will begin our committee reports next. And while we only have five reports today, I assure you all our committees are still active, but don't have a great deal to report right now. But the committees that we have working all year long put in a tremendous amount of work, time, and understanding, and they're good listeners, which is very important. So let's start with the first committee, the Christmas Fund Committee, Mike Cieslak.
Good evening.
In the May and June tower topics, were P2H2 help wanted ads for volunteers from the villas to assist in the annual Residence Council Employee Christmas Fund. To date, there's only been a couple of interested responses. I would like a few more volunteers. No one living in the villas has experienced the Christmas Fund. So I want to hold a short meeting with volunteers to explain the Christmas Fund and what would be expected of the volunteers. Please let me or Linda know if you'd be interested. Thank you. Any questions? Any volunteers? No volunteers?
I'm sure the volunteers are forthcoming, even if we have to ask them to be volunteers. Dan is next, Dan McCracken with the Finance Committee.
The financial statement for Plymouth Place activities through May, can't read that, through May show operating margin is positive to budget. The loan covenant requirements, minimum debt service coverage, and minimum days cash are both exceeded. Plymouth Place occupancy at the end of May was 93%. The most recent figures for senior living facility occupancy in the U.S. is 83%. We are way ahead. Plymouth Place is in strong financial position.
Thank you, Dan. I have to make comments about the food committee because I made an error. That's nothing unusual, but this is a magnitude numbers. Pat Rosinski has been the chairman of the food committee for as long as I can remember. And when I was preparing the agenda, I got the food committee and I just wrote down Pat Rosinski. Last May, Jim McCarty became the new leader of the food committee. So, with my apologies, Dan, it's all yours.
Okay, I gotta get my glasses. The food committee is proud of the work the food service people do. Sherry, Lily, Edith, Maria, and Mark have taken us to new heights with the impressive meals that have been served. I'm sure you have noticed in our new weekly menu, which has been updated to give the vegetarians choices and also to list next week's Sunday menu. The pub is thriving, especially in entertainment nights like tonight. Were you there, anybody?
Yeah.
Sarah Tudor Dining Room is busy. The bistro is crowded at lunchtime, and 30 North is doing very well with expanded service of the Sunday Supper Club and the new luncheon offerings. Please remember to make reservations. It's so helpful in their planning. The new outdoor kitchen is coming along with assuming offering pizzas and other specialty items. I think if Sherry told me today, probably in a week or so. So you'll be able to go there, order a pizza, a salad, a drink. They'll have a chef there. So I'm really looking forward to this. This ought to be really a lot of fun. The outdoor grills are being used. We enjoyed many specialty dinners such as Mother's Day, Father's Day, breakfast at Tiffany's, Here comes the brides, Memorial Day brunch, and all the specialties from 30 North, such as Cinco de Mayo, Taco Bar, Spanish Tapas, Greeks, Foods of the Gods, and the Father's Day barbecue. The Passover Seder, Run for the Roses, Kentucky Derby Party, and most recently, the Juneteenth dinner with a band afterwards in Dole Hall. The wine club is very popular the last Wednesday of the month. Again, please make your reservations. It's great. We have a lot of fun. Taste some great wines. Our birthday bashes are not to be missed, and they're always so special. I hope you enjoyed the dish, always full of fun and interesting information. Be sure to check the bulletin board outside the library for events. I want to compliment all the residents who have been careful handling the RSVPs so that cancellations are being made in a timely manner. And lastly, Pat Rozanski would like to say the liver lovers and the pork and beans people are very happy. Thank you, folks.
Thank you, Jim. I have three people lined up to remind me that you're the chairman. Next, we go to program committee. Jody Lewis is the chair.
We have a number of programs lined up for July and August, and we hope you enjoy them all. July 16th, Chris Garofalo will be giving us a classical piano concert with a great variety of music in it. July 25th, Jenny Riddle will be impersonating Barbara Walters and talking about showing how her rise, breaking the glass ceiling. On July 30th, Lonesome Eagle will present a folk music concert. August 15th, Sam DeWeese, baritone, will be giving us a concert. Some of you probably remember him from the latest Lyric Opera Artists who came. He was the young man who grew up in LaGrange and sang some of my favorite things from that concert. He did a wonderful aria from Peter Grimes and the humorous Flanders and Swan song about the bath. August 21st, Clark Snavely is a young violinist, classical violinist, who is an extraordinary, extraordinary musician. He'll be giving us a concert. And on August 28th, Reginald Robinson will come with a ragtime piano concert. So, hope you enjoy.
Thank you, Jody. Welcome committee is next. Kathy Blanford, please.
Thank you, Art. I'll say your name right. You know, if I had had any idea how much work is involved in being the welcoming committee chairperson, I would have taken on the job regardless. Meeting new residents is often fun and always a privilege. There are so many interesting people coming to Plymouth Place. And that's nothing to say about the dogs. I got to meet Jilly over in the villa. And all of you have been very welcoming to our little Luna. Thank you for that. The welcoming committee is now made up of five people in addition to myself. Carol Brexick has generously offered to stay on to help with the transition. New members are Helen Chan and Ellen Griffith from the villas, and Linda Roberts and Mary Bart from the Landing. We're now visiting each new resident as a team of two committee members, usually a new committee member combined with either Carol or myself. And this has been quite successful as new committee members become oriented to the welcoming process. It's also often helpful to have two people present to pick up on and respond to questions and concerns of the new residents. I also want to thank Sue Johnston, who has also stayed around and picked up a few of the stragglers, which we've been very appreciative of. Since I became chair, the welcoming committee has met with four new residents in the Landing and eight in the villas. I'm aware that there are many of you who have moved in before I took this position, people that I do not know. And that feels really strange to be a chair of the welcoming committee and not know a number of you. Please introduce yourself to me when we meet and feel free to reach out if I can ever be of any assistance to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. Before we move into the administrative report, we do have some new business, and it is new business. Would Sherry Bublis please come forward and make a new introduction?
Thank you. So this is a really big treat for me to be able to make this introduction. You know, I've been at Plymouth Place 5 years, and probably the first 3 years, we worked with a gentleman in our production kitchen, our very tiny production kitchen, named Jim Frazina. And he moved on to the University of Chicago, and I can tell you that most of the kitchen cried when he left. He visited us, I don't know, maybe 6 months ago. He was in the neighborhood, and he just wanted to stop by and see how we were doing. And what I always remember about Jim is his wife, because I would often say, well, what's she doing? Because I knew she was a talented chef, and she had a lot of experience that I thought would just be such a dream to have here. So I think it's all by chance. Maybe it's karma, but it is definitely, I think, our fortune to be able to now have Michelle Frazina as part of our team. Michelle will be the director for culinary services. You know, I'm blessed to have people like Kathleen Riley, Sharon Anderson, people who are so committed not only to services and residents here, but I think in setting a standard for customer service. So Michelle, I think, will be an amazing fit, but I did ask her to just share a little bit about her background. But I want you to know that moving forward, any food question, any food comment, we have gone over and over the fact that this is truly your home. And we often say that if we've made a mistake, it's not like we can avoid you for the rest of our days here. You will come back. You will haunt us. So I'm going to let Michelle share a little bit about herself. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Sherry. That was lovely. Like Sherry said, my husband worked here in the past, and he would always come home and just, it was a hard job. It's a lot of work, but he loved coming to work. He loved the people he worked with, and he loved the residents and just how pleasant and wonderful everything at Plymouth Place was. And I was always like, this sounds kind of nice. I thought about it for retirement, not necessarily working here, but it turned out to be perfect. It really did. My background is I went to culinary school in New York, the Culinary Institute of America, many, many moons ago, so I have my culinary degree from them. I moved on and worked in a conference center way out west in St. Charles, that's where we're from, and worked there for 30 years. So I worked in the back of the house, the front of the house, did a little bit of everything, bartending, service, events, catering, table setup, dishes, whatever it took. My last position there was the director of food and beverage. So we had a very, very large capacity. We had 1,042 guest rooms, and we served people from around the world. So it set me up kind of for a large community, and it's something I really enjoyed. A year ago, I was at Hilton in Rosemont, and it was about this big. And it was too small, and I was bored.
We'll fix that.
Yes, I keep being told by anybody I say that to, you won't be bored here. So I'm looking forward to that, though. I like to keep active. I like to keep moving. I want to try new things. I want to hear what people have to say and what you're all looking for. So I'm really, really looking forward to being here for a long time and enjoying what Plymouth Place has to offer. So thank you.
Okay.
Michelle, I guarantee you, you'll be very busy if you follow Sherry, okay? Moving into the administration report now, we will have a threefold presentation, starting with Kathleen Riley and then Nicole Hibbard, and we'll have Patty Holman wrap it up.
Good evening. Mark, Tuesday, July 23rd, on your calendar, we have the Secretary of State mobile unit coming to Plymouth Place. And that's due to the efforts of Art Grunke, Don Alm, and Joyce Lynn. So thank you all very much for that. The mobile unit is coming to Plymouth Place, like I said, Tuesday, July 23rd, from 10 o'clock to 4 o'clock p.m., right here in Dole Hall. In order to vote in the upcoming presidential election on November 5th, you may need to change your address, obtain a new ID or real ID or state ID, or you might wish to obtain other types of conveniences, a vehicle sticker, or to become an organ or tissue donor. Acceptable forms of payment include Visa, MasterCard, American Express, checks, or money order. These are the two documents that I placed outside on the Dole Hall, on the table at the entrance to Dole Hall, so please feel free to pick these up. It gives you all the information that you need for Tuesday, July 23rd, from 10 o'clock to 4 p.m. here in Dole Hall. Thank you.
Yes.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm so excited to be back on the agenda tonight. Art made a point to tell me, oh, you're speaking tonight. So I'm always so grateful to be here and present to you. I was asked tonight to present on music. How many of you went to the Sound of Summer event that we had out on the lawn? Yeah, what a great event, right? Let's give a round of applause to Plymouth Place for that. So what I want to present on tonight is, how does music impact the lives of people living with brain change? And then to follow up on that, I want to talk to you about how we, as care partners at Plymouth Place, are utilizing music to connect with our individuals in our community throughout the continuum that are living with brain change. And that's not just me, right? That's not just memory care. That goes throughout our departments, including culinary, including life enrichment, including our volunteer programs. And so those are my two topics. I get so excited to present to you all that I oftentimes talk really fast. So I want to be articulate, and I want you to understand how all of these programs fit together. Because the majority of these programs are through our scholarship program or they're donor funded. And so I think it's important to highlight how all of this kind of just fits together in our crazy minds of madness and in our crazy activities programming. So I'm going to start with, how does music impact the lives of people living with brain change throughout our continuum? Of course, I've talked to you before about our Teepa Snow Positive Approach to Care program that we've been so fortunate through philanthropy and our scholarship program that we've gotten money donated to us through very generous people to kind of fund that program. That program is used for education, and I'll highlight that a little bit later. Music in our program, as we highlighted through the Sounds of Summer and forward, it's a connector, right? We know that. We know that for people living with dementia. Music is oftentimes used to set up mood, and mood sets up our internal chemistry, and that's what we know. You can oftentimes, and you can ask the singing sages who are all up here, some of them, you can ask the singing sages, even people that are totally and completely not engaged will tap their foot or they will tap their hand when they're singing God Bless America or anything that reverts back to a memory from previous. And so music is such a powerful tool, and we know that, right? So why is music so important to us going forward? It's not just a philanthropy effort. We know that it's going to make a difference in the lives of our residents throughout the continuum, including independent living, including the Arboretum Villas, including the third floor, including AL, including memory care, and we know that. We know that, right? And so music as a whole is what we're focused on right now, and so I think that's why I was asked to present on this. Humans, we know, connect with music. We connect those experiences to emotional experiences, whether it be from our childhood, whether it be from the loss of a spouse, whether it be through grieving, whether it be through a happy moment, right? So if you think back, it's the last thing you lose. It's the first thing you gain, and it's the last thing you lose. Even a child will be able to identify certain songs and rhythms, and it's the last thing we lose, right, as we age. Music and rhythm are retained in our right temporal lobes, which, again, the last thing we lose. And so regardless of our progression of our stages of brain change, we know that even if we go, right, it's automatic. You don't have to think about it. So that's what we know. We know that rhythm, and we know that music ability, that we still can make a connection to the very end, right? The other thing I'm highlighting, which I want to talk about how music impacts the lives of people living with brain changes. How many of you have heard of Lady Gaga? Not as many. How many of you have heard of Tony Bennett? Okay. So I don't know if you saw the performance where they performed together. Tony Bennett was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease in 2016. His family didn't make that public until 2021. In the meantime, he recorded two albums with Lady Gaga that both won Grammys. Both of them won Grammys. And so Gaga said, there were times where he could not even remember my name, but we got on stage and the music played and it was like he was the same as he always was, right? Their last performance together was for his 95th birthday. On his 95th birthday, they performed on stage together. And even though he was able to retain those abilities as an artist and he was able to perform, you would have never knew he had dementia. But at the end of that, she had to walk arm in arm with him off stage. So even though he wasn't able to retain those abilities past that performance and he didn't know who she was, he still was able to shine like a superstar at his 95th birthday party celebration. He didn't pass away for 2 years after that, but that was his last performance on stage with her. And she partnered with him as a human being, as somebody that loved him for so many years. And so that's really just, if you want to put things into perspective and how music changes people and how music is so intrinsic to human beings, I think that's a good example. So Google it. Google the performance. It's unbelievable. Tony, he retained his abilities and skills through music and rhythm, and that's what that was all about. And his family was so complimentary of Lady Gaga, which is of probably not even my generation. I feel like I'm too old for Lady Gaga, but your grandkids' generation or whatever, you know, that is. And so I think that was a really cool story to highlight for everyone. So I encourage you to Google that performance. It was really incredible. So how are we as care partners at Plymouth Place really just embracing music to connect with our individuals that are living with brain change through our scholarship program and through other funded programs? You guys have stood here and you've heard me talk about positive approach to care through TIPA Snow. You've heard us come up here and you've heard us talk about the Life Bio program. We now have the Steinway. And we also have a really new program through Songs by Heart. And so I want to just kind of go through each one of those with you to kind of tell you how it all fits together in the grand scheme of things. When you donate money, we want to tell you what it's used for. And in the upper levels of living, for me, I feel like it's our responsibility to tell you how impactful this money is to our residents, how impactful these programs are to our residents living with brain change, regardless of whether they're in the Arboretum Villas, regardless of whether they're on the third floor, regardless of whether they're on the eighth floor, it doesn't matter. It really just affects every single part of our continuum in a positive way. And so I want to share that with you. So of course, our positive approach to Care Tipa Snow program is our educational program that we decided through our philanthropy program and our scholarship fund to invest in. And so many of you, not going to name names, have invested money into our scholarship program as a result of that dementia education and training, because family members can see that it's making a difference. We're using it to educate our life enrichment team. We're using it to educate our clinical team to learn how to better relate and understand what our residents are actually living with and going through. Highlight, right? So like, great, we're learning how to better communicate with people. We're learning how to better understand what they're feeling, what they're going through. And it's been so great. I can't speak enough about the Positive Approach to Care Tipa Snow program. You guys will see that our journey is to become a PAC-designated facility in our memory care. We're working on that. We're working through those challenges. But we're still on course to be able to do that. And I'm really excited about that. Our staff is excited about that. And so, you know, thank you for those of you who donated to that. This also ties into our Life Bio. And we're like, gosh, how can our Life Bio program really come into this whole music situation? And we know with our residents living with dementia, our Life Bio program is designed to ask you, like, what did you do when you were little? Who's your husband? What's your name? You like all of these simple, simple things. But when I ask you, what's your favorite song? What was your first dance with your husband? What was your, right? So you understand that these types of questions lead to our ability to. We have a gentleman from our second floor that comes down here before church, and Fabian told me this. He comes down here before church. He plays the Beatles on the Steinway. He comes down here every week before church, or some weeks before church, so that the Beatles can be played for him on the Steinway, because that's positive memories for him about something, right? And so what a generous donor gift. What a gift to our residents that are aging in place, and what a gift to our residents that are, you know, going through cognitive changes. So Life Bio, the idea behind Life Bio and incorporating that into our music is just that. We're going to ask you, what triggers your memories? What triggers your memories? We're going to ask your loved ones, what triggers their memories? What were favorite songs that mom played growing up, so that we can play those for them, so that even if though we can't get a reaction, we can get a foot tap. We can provide somebody with something that stimulates something in them, in their bodies, right? The Steinway, I think it goes without saying. I know that Fabian's really good in the mornings about setting up the Steinway for success. And I learned tonight that the Aspirio app, I didn't know that the Aspirio app and Steinway were different. I thought it was called the Aspirio Steinway. So I learned something new today too, but it's the app. So I'm telling you, our memory care residents have come in here. This screen has been down, and we've had experiences through our life enrichment program with the Steinway playing, where they're able to hear the music and they're able to be visually stimulated in the background with the Aspirio app. And what an amazing thing that our life enrichment team does through Kathleen and Sherry and their team. And then the last thing I want to highlight is our newest program, which is a vendor-funded program, which is Songs by Heart, which you have not been introduced to you yet, but I'm going to introduce it tonight, so stay tuned. Songs by Heart is a non-for-profit organization dedicated to improving the quality of life for dementia sufferers throughout the power of music. It's an engagement-centered program that's led by professional quality singers and pianists who have been trained in a therapeutic technique such as mirroring. We know through our Tipa Snow program that if our staff sits there and eats with our residents, they're going to mirror what our staff does, right? So it's not only socialization, it's also mirroring. Songs are chosen to reflect the specific preferences and needs of each group, which is what I was just talking about through our Life Bio program. We want to know what music our residents are into. I don't know if it's the Beatles. I don't know if it's Bach. I don't know if it's Beethoven. I don't know if it's Lady Gaga. But we're going to get down to what their interests are, and we're going to play that music for them so that it stimulates them, whatever it is. And then songs by heart, they may come in on the weekend. They may come in during the week. We don't know. But I'm telling you, if you Google songs by heart, if you go on their website and you watch their videos and you can see the one-on-one interaction that they have with people to do, right? They get people's attention and they stimulate people's hearts. And so thank you to Patty and the philanthropy team for always looking out for our residents and always thinking about the next big thing that we can do for our residents, because I'm telling you, music is it. I want to tell you about some things that we have done already with the Steinway and some upcoming programs that we have coming up. We had Spring Fest in April, which was in Dole Hall, and Sherry and her team provided hors d'oeuvres and refreshments, and Kathleen and her team provided the entertainment. The screen was down, and the Steinway was playing in the background, and there was visual stimulation as well as that musical stimulation. That was in April. So coming up in August, we also have Summerfest. So they called that Springfest. We had Summerfest coming up in August. Same thing. All of the upper levels of living came to Dole Hall, and it will happen again in August, which is so cool. It's so cool if you just come down here and watch it. Even if you watch it from the sideline, it's so cool to see. But anyway, Summerfest is coming. I don't know what the theme of it's going to be. I haven't heard about that, but that's on August 7th. I'm not sure of the time. I should have been more prepared. I'm sorry. But it's going to be on August 7th, probably in the afternoon at some point in time. So I encourage you to just to walk by and watch what happens as the Steinway plays and the screen comes down and the hors d'oeuvres are served and our life enrichment team works their magic, as well as many upcoming experiences. Patty and I have talked about multiple times, like there are times in memory care, and if you have been down in memory care, you know there are times in memory care where we have residents that are suffering from anxiety. They're trying to get out of memory care. They're having behaviors, which I hate that term. But you know that they're struggling. And sometimes when you take them to a private location and you play music for them, it resets their whole situation. And so I think going forward, the idea is for Life Enrichment to plan more frequent situations where we can use this, even if it's on a one-on-one basis, the Steinway, even if it's on a one-on-one basis, to bring people in here, close it off for all the external stimulations, and allow them to just relax. And that's what it's all about, right? Is to allow them to just relax. So I don't have anything else. Thank you for allowing me to present to you. I know Patty's coming up now to present. So thank you. I appreciated being here tonight.
I see the weather outside. Raining. And all I can think of is Nancy Conforti. Where is she here? She put a song in my head today. Do-be-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I'm singing in the rain. I'm singing in the rain. What a glorious feeling. I'm happy again. I walk down the lane with a hap, hap, happy refrain. I'm singing and danging, dancing and singing, whatever, in the rain. Doo-dee-doo-doo. How's it going, everyone? Great job. You know, just to sit down the back and to hear the reports and, you know, to hear our staff talk, you know, aging gracefully, or whatever you might call it, where we're growing older, it's not for the faint-hearted. Not for the faint-hearted. Presents its challenges throughout, you know, throughout our life. But I must say, what a real privilege to be at Plymouth Place. You know, I had the opportunity on Sunday. I think, you know, first of all, I was MOD here on Sunday, and I was dressed up in my County Cork colours, and I took over the lower level game room to watch my team in Ireland win. It was amazing. And we played the final in 2 weeks' time. And then afterwards, I got back into, you know, my normal gear, and I had the most cherished opportunity to be part of Don and Donna the Brawl's wedding vow renewal ceremony. You know, and we're in the process of working on our upcoming Monarch magazine, and the theme is on metamorphosis, the different life cycles of a beautiful monarch. And all I can think of is the different life cycles of Plymouth Place. And to think that Don and Donna the Brawl got married in 1950. 74 years they've been married. And they've only ever moved three times. And they moved to Plymouth Place in 2008. And I look at the Brawls. Let's give them a clap. I don't know if they're looking in tonight. And then I think of someone like Maria Landivar, who's in our people services. And Maria Landivar, she comes from South America. There was a story written about her. I think of the different life cycles that how Plymouth is swirling around in people's lives. Maria came here to America, learned English. She's a qualified doctor. Just got nominated for the top 30 under 40 by West Suburban Chamber. Isn't that amazing? That's the American dream being lived out each and every day. And I think of others who were recently down, recent residents here, who were down at the Rolling Stones. Who attended the Rolling Stones? We have residents that just went down and saw there. Plymouth Place is allowing people to live out their lives with the greatest of dignity and respect. Have fun, have lots of fun, and congratulations, Art. You know, because it's those cycles of life that Plymouth Place is so much involved and wrapped around, creating those conditions to allow people to do what they do with a passion, and the rest will always follow. So I just want to thank you for all that you do. Thank you for your support of Plymouth Place. People give their time, their talent, and their treasure here in abundance at Plymouth Place. And it just so happens that we are in the middle of our annual fund support, so I wanted to give an update on that. But I do think, though, that, you know, our role really in philanthropy is just about listening, seeing where the match is. And if it's with Plymouth Place, then comes the creative possibilities that what can be achieved. I look at Mr. Steinway or Mrs. Steinway here. It gives us no greater joy to walk in the door in the morning and the first thing you hear is Steinway, you know. Kind of sets the tone. And then as we, just to hear Nicole talk about the different programs that are being set up. I do know the songs by heart. I was involved in introducing songs by heart at three previous communities that I was part of. They're led by a lady called Nancy Gustafson. She, if you Google her, Nancy Gustafson on YouTube, you'll see her up singing with Pavarotti. Incredible person. And we certainly hope to get Nancy here with her team and maybe put on a concert. Because, you know, music is a wonderful opportunity to engage with people. We all have a song, you know. My mother always said, have three songs in your back pocket at any one time. No matter what the mood, and never forget them. But the annual fund takes place. It's came out in May. We will formally finish it up by the end of August. Now, people give at different cycles throughout the year. And if your passion is for music and you want to make a gift through the annual fund to that, come see us. We will make that happen. If it is to the scholarship fund and you have an interest in that, come see us and we will make that happen. We're so grateful for the new outdoor kitchen that's just about to occur. Again, that came about through somebody wishing to honor the legacy of Nancy Dixon and also honor Chef Lily, who does amazing work. And now we have a beautiful rotisserie chicken and pizza oven. We do like to eat here, let's be honest, you know. And again, the Community Arts Fund that we talked about through the recent concert, I think, you know, that was a sort of a new development, and maybe we took a little bit of a risk. Thanks be to God, the weather held up for us. It was great. But thank you to the volunteers here. It's the volunteers who make all of this happen. There's no reason why we're 93% full. It's because people get that sense when you come through the front door at Plymouth Place, they say, wow, there's something magical that's happening here at Plymouth Place. And there really, really is. And long may it continue. So our role really in philanthropy is about giving people that opportunity if they wish to give back and make a difference, whether it's through an immediate cash gift or through their IRA or qualified charitable distribution to make that gift back to Plymouth Place. All gifts to Plymouth Place are fully tax deductible. We're a not-for-profit. And you look at Plymouth Place like, wow, it is absolutely incredible. But I hope you see when you lift up the hood of everything that's happening. And it's that partnership, that trust that takes place between the leadership, the board, and the residents who are all working together. And as we serve not just everyone here, our staff and their families, and the wider community. I think, you know, Jay has always talked about that sense of the lighthouse. Anyone that went to the fireside chats of, you know, the lighthouse is guiding through rough waters and safe ways and all that. And I often think about, what if there was no lighthouse? What if there was no Plymouth Place? I think about the impact and the presence of such an amazing organization here in the heart of the southwest suburbs. And I think through, there's great things to happen to come. We just want to say thank you so much. We will be putting up a thermometer on the lower level just to give people a sense of where we're at. To give people a sense of where we're at, to date, the annual fund all in has brought in close to $550,000 this year. Thank you. We certainly would like to get it between 850 and more, but people give pertaining to their budget. So like in this case, in the Steinway's case, the donors reached out to us and said, we'd like to maybe give through their entrance refund. And we were able to make that happen because we have the day's cash on hand to make that happen. So you get to see the joy now. And that's the beauty of philanthropy. So again, Art, hope I haven't taken up too much of your time. Thank you so much and have a lovely evening.
Thank you very much, Patty. Thank you all for coming tonight. Our next meeting is September 10th. Hope to see you there. This meeting is adjourned.